this is, some call a recent research that inspired, research results that have inspired to give lectures on that topic. And also, already I have explained some general things about quantum criticality, what it is, and so on. And I remind you that in conventional picture of quantum criticality, what one gets is the following thing, that if we have some ordered state, like ferromagnet or antiferromagnet or some superconductors, for example, granular superconductor, then one has a critical line separating the ordered phase from the disordered phase. And a quantum phase transition is a phase transition as a function of some parameter characterizing the system. This parameter can be, in many cases, just the doping level, or it can be for Josephson junctions, it could be, for example, Josephson energy, Josephson coupling between the grains, and there is a transition at zero temperature. And then what we have learned last time was that if we may have this critical line, and as soon at any finite temperature, as soon as we are close to the phase transition line, then we are in the classical region. So that's for any quantum system. At finite temperatures, if we are close enough, we are in the classical region. Then at zero temperature, all this criticality near the transition is, of course, purely quantum criticality. And then at a finite but low temperatures, we have a region where already we are in the critical region, but at the same time, this critical region is all, has a quantum character. If we are far enough from the phase transition, then this is the critical region. So, and then what was the standard business on studying this system? That here one could we got the result that quantum behavior in D dimension is equivalent to classical one. Yeah, D plus one. So. So, therefore, in that sense, there is nothing so much exciting about quantum critical transition. Simply, one has, if one is in two dimensions, for example, then we have here D dimension, D equals 2, and if you want to study quantum behavior near the quantum phase transition, we should be effectively in D plus 1 dimension, and in this D plus 1 dimension we should, which means that we are effectively in 3 dimension, and we should study the quantum phase transition, which means that we in many cases we have just second order phase transition, and we calculate some scaling relations, some critical exponents, and so on. So now, what one should do further. So since the discovery of this high temperature cuprates, people started to think about quantum criticality. This is because, so these cuprates, so one shouldn't really, in the beginning, shouldn't go very much in details of the structure. The structure can be quite complicated, but the most important feature of cuprates is that one has layers of a copper oxide layer, a lattice. And these layers, so in this case, these are somehow double layers separated by some other layer. But mostly conductivity in the lattice goes along this copper O2 layers. And this lattice is very simple. It has copper atoms and oxygen atoms, and it is a square lattice, so rather simple. But at the same time, the phase diagram is quite complicated. So if one has one electron, so one free electron, half-filled band, which means that in this band one has just one electron on copper atoms, one additional electron, then the system is just antiferromagnetic. One may think of such a picture about this antiferromagnet, that one has additional electrons, and that half-filled band case, these electrons form antiferromagnet. So the most favorable configuration is that one has simply electrons localized at these copper atoms. These are copper atoms, and oxygens are in between. And one has these electrons on the copper atoms. They do not move, more or less, due to some interaction that if electron would move, then it would cost a lot of energy. And they are localized on copper atoms, and then there is some exchange interaction between spins of the electrons. And the most favorable configuration is that you have alternating spins of the electrons. So one copper atom spin up, the other spin down, and so on. And this builds a lattice of the system of spins, and the lowest energy corresponds to antiferromagnet. And this is what one observes in the phase diagram. This is phase diagram which has been known almost from the beginning of high TC business. One has this doping. Doping means that you add more electrons into the system. So this can be done by some chemical means and so on. So if we don't have doping, this means that one has one additional. One can think of one electron sitting on copper atoms, interacting in this way and forming antiferromagnet. Then you add more electrons by some means. So there are many ways to do that. One can, for thin layers, one can do this doping just by applying an electrostatic potential, and then more electrons get into the system. One has different chemical means to do that, but one can add more electrons. And then this is what happens when doping the system with electrons. And very soon, at rather low doping levels, so several percent of additional electrons, added here, and antiferromagnetism is destroyed. Then the antiferromagnetic order disappears. Then, in the early days, what one discovered, okay, and first what one has discovered, it was the superconducting phase with very high superconducting temperature, and which reaches, I guess, maximum is 140, so between 120 and 140 Kelvin, which is quite high. And everything would be rather simple and understandable. One could think of this high values, speak of this high values of superconductivity, but then later it has become clear that everything is more complicated. There is one region which is called pseudogap state. Pseudogap means that one has not quite metallic behavior of electrons of the system. One has some gap which is characterized by temperature, for example, temperature behavior of different physical quantities, as if it was some kind of semiconductor with some and then this was just the beginning. The diagram is as simple, looked simple from the beginning, but then now people, for decades people were talking about stripe behavior, some stripes having both spin and charge degrees of freedom. Nowadays, last 1-2 years, people, even I would say 1 year, people discuss a lot about charge order that is seen here, and superconducting phase can be destroyed rather easily by comparatively low fields, and one sees some charge order instead. So everything is extremely complicated. And now back to quantum criticality. Of course, there are different ways of thinking, and from the beginning, many powerful people thought in terms of just strong interaction without referring to quantum criticality, quantum phase transition. This was mainly from the beginning due to Phil Henderson. Other people also were proposing their own ideas, and there were, of course, thousands of different ideas, but one of them was also that one should remember that we are near a quantum phase transition, and everything should be due to quantum phase transition, to the closeness to some quantum phase transition. I have given you the picture of what one can expect from quantum phase transition, from the quantum phase transition, and then the question, everything here looks different. It's not just some different exponents as one could expect near this critical point. Somehow one gets superconductivity, and what is pseudogap, and so on. So all those things are not answered, cannot be answered in this picture of quantum phase transition. Or they could not. So, therefore, it's clear that if one wants to think about, explanation of physics of cuprates in terms of quantum phase transitions, one should do something more. Actually, our motivation to start this business was not cuprates. We simply wanted to study one more So special case of quantum phase transition, and this special case that we wanted to study was that we have antiferromagnet. Usually one thinks about destroying the antiferromagnetic quota in such terms that electrons remain seated here in these atoms, simply the order is destroyed. And this is conventional antiferromagnet disordered state phase transition. But here in these systems, there is another scenario how this antiferromagnet is destroyed, and this destruction occurs due to doping, and not only just antiferromagnetic order is destroyed, but also electrons are able to move. If you add a little bit more electrons into the system, some electrons, they already cannot just simply get into the same sites, because the repulsion between electrons can be strong, and they should be distributed between all these copper and oxygen atoms. And actually this leads to the possibility that they can start moving. And this means that already not only antiferromagnet is destroyed, but also electrons start moving, and one gets something like metallic behavior. So this means that more degrees of freedom should be taken into account. Not only spin degrees of freedom, but already electrons can start moving. And one should write a system describing both those degrees of freedom. So now, therefore, now I move. To description, taking into account not only the spin degrees of freedom, but also motion of electrons. So, previously, what I have derived was this effective action phi here, but letter delta. Phi was the phase of this delta. So generally, I tried to show you that in order to describe quantum behavior near the phase transition, one should use just almost conventional Ginzburg-Landau expansion, but one has the additional variable. One has not only the coordinates here, but one has also imaginary time, and this imaginary time varies from 0 to 1 over temperature, and one has the additional term of that time. So that was... And if I wanted to describe antiferromagnet, so just I would call it conventional of quantum antiferromagnet. In this case, we would introduce phi, so for example, three-dimensional vector, and this vector characterizes the antiferromagnet. So the average momentum would be phi multiplied, phi of r multiplied by, it's better to write that it is proportional to I q r, where q is just the vector between, so wave vector corresponding to this period, double period of the lattice. So, and then this behavior would correspond to such oscillation. So Q vector can be something like pi divided by A, pi divided by A, where A is this elementary lattice length. So, and then one, with such a vector, one has such an oscillation, and speaking in terms of this conventional picture of phase transitions, I would say that S, describing this action of the antiferromagnet, had to be written in such a form that it should be something like K, and here D phi D tau squared plus some C, and here D vector phi, and here gradient squared plus, sorry, here I should subtract minus I q phi, and here squared, and plus here the term is phi squared, and here the term is g 1/2 phi squared. So this derivative corresponds to the oscillation that I have displayed here, and conventional description of the antiferromagnet would contain quantum phase transition, would contain this field phi and its fluctuations. For A negative, one can have minimum which corresponds to finite phi, to finite antiferromagnetism. But already if one goes to disordered phase, one has all these fluctuations and one can have this scaling behavior and all those things. So now the question, how one can add the possibility that one that electrons can move. And now I want to describe you what is in standard way, with standard notations, called as spin fermion model. So we have only spins. In this model we have only spins. But we want to describe also the electron motion. And how can one write almost phenomenologically, but how one can write both in one glass somehow. What I write this, I want to emphasize that I will write now some kind of spin fermion model, taking into account both spins and electrons themselves. And I want to tell that this model is until now to much extent phenomenological, although easily one can easily understand what it means. In principle, even this model, it can be derived in some cases explicitly microscopically. But it is more general than that. This is, as Landau theory from the beginning is quite general. One simply writes an action of some other parameter for some other parameter. It is more general, and it can be written for some system just phenomenologically also, without going much in microscopic details. And this spin fermion model can also be written in this way, although one can try to derive it. And I simply write it in such a way. So spin fermion model. So this is a low energy description of a very complicated system. So strongly interacting electrons. What is clear, for example, about cuprates, that electrons interact with each other, so the interaction is very strong. Therefore, as usual, the interaction is very strong. One cannot make calculations explicitly analytically. So unfortunately, one can do analytical calculations for strong interaction. Usually for one-dimensional systems it is possible, but for higher dimensional systems it is almost never possible. And therefore one should do approximations. Here the situation is even more tricky, because if one tries to do numerical simulations, and usually one uses very powerful Monte Carlo method. Here, due to presence of fermions, these Monte Carlo methods are also not applicable. So at least the results cannot be obtained in a short time, due to a so-called sign problem, which is a very famous problem, and still it has not been overcome. And due to that fact, information about, for example, the Hubbard model, two-dimensional Hubbard model, in the most interesting cases when it should show superconductivity, numerics is also fails also, either because the advantages of Monte Carlo method is that you can calculate everything, and the computation time grows in the power law in the size of the system or inverse temperature, but if you have sign problem it becomes exponential, and this means one cannot really calculate. So I mentioned all these things only to say that this problem to study these cuprates is intrinsically extremely complicated from both analytical and numerical point of view. And therefore, when one wants to write some simplified explanation, simplified model, taking into account low energy degrees of freedom, this means that in principle there are reasons why one should still simplify this model. Okay, so this simplification is the spin-Fermion model, which says, tells you that the starting point is that we want to start with the quantum phase transition, and near the quantum phase transition to write a proper low energy description. So this is a low energy description. Low energy description near quantum critical point. And if you want to start doing some theory, it is usually necessary to write the model. If you don't write the model, you don't know what to calculate. And the model, one writes the action, so this is action, and one writes simply the action as S psi plus S phi, containing two parts, where S phi is just this one. So S phi, one writes as the integral beta, and here K d phi L squared plus C, and here gradient minus I q k phi squared plus phi squared plus j phi squared squared. So I write here just the coefficient unity, so all ones half. It can be chosen just by rescaling of the field phi. So here gradients, one shouldn't be confused. This is vector in the space of spins of magnetic moments, and this vector is in the space of coordinates. So and this means that we write these two terms. This means that one term is just slowly fluctuating antiferromagnetic moments. And the second part, we want to take into account the motion of electrons. We should introduce not only the magnetic moment, but also electrons. And these electrons are described by this term as psi, and psi is here is a field, fermionic field, describing the electrons. And this can be written in such a form as psi d psi d tau. Here one should write, of course, these spins of electrons, and then one writes as usual epsilon minus I gradient. I write it in such a form, and here psi sigma, and here psi sigma, and plus lambda, and here I write psi sigma and sigma here, and here Pauli matrices, this is phi, and this is psi sigma, and d phi tau, and in principle the sum of the sigma 1, 2, these are spins of this field. So what is written here? We have electrons characterized by fermionic field. And this fermionic field, we have, so this part means the following, that we have the fermionic field, and these fermions are free fermions. So if we don't put for a while lambda equals zero, these are just free fermions. So this means that in the zeroth approximation, we have just magnetic moments fluctuating in time, and we have a spin, we have fermions. And in this description, they are somehow different entities. So these magnetic moments exist and electrons exist. Of course, this is not quite correct if we think about the microscopic picture, because in the microscopic picture we have only electrons or holes, and they interact via Coulomb interaction, and for example one can write Hubbard-like model. But this is a low energy theory. This means that we somehow take into account high energies and integrating out high energies, and these high energies give us this antiferromagnet normal metal transition. And then already we take into account very low energy behavior. So high energy in condensed matter means electron volt, which is Fermi energy or characteristic energy of that kind of electron volt. And we are interested in description at low energy, at low temperature, or high temperature superconductivity means several hundred Kelvin. Say room temperature is low energy, but room temperature is 270 Kelvin, which is, and one electron volt means 10,000 Kelvin. So this means that we work always in the low energy limit, low temperature limit. And therefore, and typical temperatures for antiferromagnetic transitions are high, they can be 1000 Kelvin, and therefore we are in the limit of low energy field. So therefore, we say phenomenologically that we want to have such a system that contains both this magnetic, slow magnetic amount, fluctuations of magnetic moment. We have electrons, with electrons have their own spins. And the electrons, the spins of the electrons interact with this magnetic moment. So this is Pauli matrix sigma, and this Pauli matrix describes the interaction with the magnetic moment.
Yeah. Can you comment on the sign of lambda? Whether you want the electrons?
Sorry, it is not important.
Okay, you don't want them to align, I mean. That's my question.
In principle, so phi is fluctuating. Of course, one can think of this model that phi, that electron spins want to be locally along this phi. Of course, such tendency.
So is this a good picture?
Okay, you want to write lambda with minus lambda. The point is that we will consider today. We'll consider everything from the metallic side of the transition. Therefore, phi fluctuates, and you don't have everything is invariant under replacement phi to minus phi. Therefore, in that respect, the sign of lambda is simply not important. But even if I were in the anti-ferromagnetic side of the transition, and nevertheless, this is somehow, this can be arbitrary choice what to call magnetic moment. But anyway, now it won't be important for us. So this is the model, which means that it contains magnetic moments, fluctuating magnetic moments, plus electrons interacting with these magnetic moments. This epsilon is spectrum of these effective electrons. Which spectrum is not very important, because if you know basics of physics of solid state, of metals, you know that usually what is important is the vicinity of the Fermi surface, because in the vicinity of the Fermi surface, so all these phenomena, what we have in metals usually occur in the vicinity of Fermi surface. Characteristic temperatures we have, even at room temperature, is 300 Kelvin, Fermi surface is 10,000 Kelvin. So therefore, usually we are just near the Fermi surface. So therefore, at the moment, I do not specify what kind of spectrum we have, and just let me introduce this model in this general form, and then start discussing its quantities, its properties. So we have fluctuating magnetic moments, and we have fermions. So usually, if one wants to be cautious about terminology, these are not those original electrons that are in the systems. These are effective fermions, so corresponding to this low energy physics, some kind of quasi particles, and these are magnetic moments. So, and it turns out that this model is very rich in terms of displaying different phase transitions. So, therefore, this model is somehow on the market for quite a long time. Attempts to study this quantum phase transition, anti-ferromagnet phase transition, already have been undertaken quite long time ago, but at that time, even writing something like that type, models of that type, people were thinking about in terms of calculating critical exponents and so on. So then this spin fermion model was studied in much of details in several not in many publications. The main person who was pushing this direction of research is Andrei Chubukov, and with several co-authors, he studied this model in some artificial limit. The point is that you cannot just solve everything assuming this small constant lambda. It doesn't mean that you can solve everything because at the transition, because actually after some renormalization of fields and parameters, everything at the transition becomes dimensionless. And therefore, the system as usual in the quantum in critical point, you don't have small parameters. And there was a small or large parameter used by these authors to study these properties, and apparently I will do it the next half of the lecture. Now I would like to stop writing, so having displayed this spin fermion model, I want to stop on that. I hope that I succeeded to show you what new may happen, not necessarily will happen, but it may happen that if we introduce also the additional degree of freedom, in addition to magnetic moments, we add fermions, some effective fermions, and we have interaction between them.
About this artificial limit that you mentioned, the large N, is it related to the components of phi or fermion flavors?
Okay. Fermion flavors.
Okay, but so still, phi is still.
Phi is still just 3 dimensions, just conventional.
Okay, so only in a
But if one has a large number of flavors, actually, flavors you could write here. The sigma vary not from 1 to 2, but from 1 to 2n, for example. And these are a number of big number of flavors, which actually was helping, as the authors were thinking for quite a long time. Not only the authors, other people also believed that. And only in this work was noticed that there are some diagrams that are not small even at that limit. This was actually the starting point of our study of this model, but this is for the next hour and for the rest of lectures. Okay.